John Grant is an award-winning communications expert and author. As co-founder and head of strategy at creative agency St. Luke's, he created what was described by the FT as a defining moment in British culture, encouraging this once curtained nation to chuck out the chintz and embrace IKEA's Swedish cool. Since then, John has advised clients from Amazon to Unilever on everything from brands to behaviour change, with a particular focus on three main metatrends: sustainability, digital, and globalisation. His first book, The New Marketing Manifesto, The 12 Rules for Building Successful Brands in the 21st Century, was named one of the 10 best business books of 1999 and is still recommended reading today. I asked him why it has stood the test of time.
Actually, that book, I think, has stood the test of time. I was part of a quite innovative agency that did a lot of stuff with new media, and not just internet, but we made documentaries to promote BBC Radio 1. We did in-store radio for the Body Shop, and we were really waking up to the fact that as communication strategists, we'd been taught there's sort of TV and you use that for that. There's print and there's outdoor and you have a bit of radio. And it was very defined. And two things had happened. One is that there'd been an explosion of choice. So I'd done a media review for one of our banking clients. And I said, you've gone from four main media to about 200. And I don't mean media titles. I mean all the different options that you have in front of you. And this was even in the 90s. So that the choice of media became very strategic. Red Bull, for instance, was launched in that period, focusing on a very different distribution strategy, which was everywhere but the supermarkets, but it was garages, places where people would buy stuff when they'd been out late, very informal and very underground. And then they did sampling at events, and they started putting advertising into computer games. And just by the venues in which they chose to be met, created a completely different profile. And nobody had launched a successful soft drink, you know, in 50 years. And they managed to be the underground soft drink that tapped into a number of cultural trends. But the actual choice of where became really important. The other thing that happened was media literacy. And I remember a couple of times in focus groups. See, in the 1980s, it was possible to write case studies on advertising effectiveness. And I wrote a number of them. But somebody else wrote one about Levi's, saying, we put that advert on TV with the laundrette and sales increased 800%, and it crystallized. There was already a craze for American retro and that style of jeans, but that was sort of in Soho, but the whole nation went crazy for that advert. And people used to say of lager that people drink the adverts. You got into the mid-90s and people started noticing it didn't often work that way anymore, and there was an increase in media literacy. And I remember sitting in focus groups where people said, well, you know, if they were talking about Levi's, they could say, I can see they've got a really cool ad agency, but I don't think the brands are cool because my friends wear something else. And the influence of, for instance, word of mouth and people coming to their own opinion on things and not just taking, you know, the image off the television and so forth. And so the combination of new media and media literacy meant that we had to rethink the entire toolkit of, you know, what a strategy was. And the more I looked into it at that time, the more we'd inherited a number of terms like brand personality that was invented by the agencies in the 50s and 60s, who started using TV personalities and commercial TV things. And of course, if you hire Roger Moore, then your brand personality will be a bit like Roger Moore. And so we had to start to think, you know, even what is the proposition? I worked with people like Innocent Smoothies, and they were mainly known through their events. And what is the proposition of the event? It's sort of come to the event. It's actually they're creating a world, an ambient. So that is an example of where we had to start questioning, actually, what is a brand strategy? How are we connecting with people? And so after about 5 or 6 years of doing all of that, I wrote a book saying, as far as I can tell from things that I've been working with and other things that I know have been successful, there are some principles emerging which seem to be common to a number of these. And for instance, word of mouth was one of the chapters, and all about creating conversations.
A customer review written on Amazon in 2007 said of John's landmark book, I'm very happy that this was the first marketing book I chose to read. Everything is so simple and makes perfect sense. The only thing I disagree with is that aspirational advertising is over. Society has never been as celebrity-obsessed as it is now. The book was published in 2000, 13 years later. Does John agree with that review?
Around the time that you picked that review out, there was somebody contacted me from a university in Holland, a business school, and said, I'm writing a dissertation on your book, and my question is, 10 years on, do these rules still apply? And specifically, do they apply to internet brands? And he and I talked about it, and I think our consensus was most of these rules absolutely still stand, because they're talking about the sort of the modern talkers. You think about participation, communities. There were lots of those sorts of headings in there. The one that I questioned was the one of the chapters said, be famous. And that was very much the overhang of, I met a famous ad guy in Turkey recently. He sent all his clients a jar of gold dust with a label looking like a coffee jar saying instant fame. And that very much been the message from the advertising industry, is if you've got something new, we will confer instant fame, all the charisma that comes with fame, celebrity and so forth. And that's what that review's questioning. It's true that we do seem to live at times in a sort of Grazia magazine, footballers' wives world, where everybody's interested in someone's new baby or their new boyfriend or so forth. I think the extent to which brands are based on that kind of fame is something that I would question. Quite often, it's so important to be authentic that actually being a bit more discovered and holding back a bit and being a bit slow around that stuff and not sort of just going straight to the sort of spectacular. But it absolutely varies. I think one of my key conclusions in the book and in my long life working with brands and their strategies is it depends. It depends on the situation. What actually are you trying to achieve as a business or organisation? What are the key problems and blocks and challenges you face? And that, I guess, is my longer run. And that's where I think I would disagree with my books, is that there is no simple recipe. It depends what you're trying to cook and who's coming round and what it's for and so forth. So all the stuff that I really admire or that I work on, which is successful, is actually ultimately quite tailor-made and not necessarily coming out of some simple formula.